Hello, and welcome to Devlog number 15. This one's a little overdue because I was underway for a short time during this sprint, so I lost a lot of working time, so I pushed the deadline back a bit. But here we are now. The footage you're seeing in the background is a match that I played last night against one of my testers. We streamed that on Discord, and he was convinced that an all-missile fleet was the ultimate meta and that nothing could beat it. And unfortunately for me, he definitely proved himself right. This is the second of the two matches that we played, and he beat me in both of them. So that means there's going to have to be some real careful thought into rebalancing the missiles, not necessarily on how much damage they do on a hit, because I am happy with that, but in the other compounding factors such as how many you can carry, how much they cost, etc. But we'll talk about all that at the end. In the meantime, let's talk about the gameplay changes that I intended to implement this sprint. The first of these changes is to the tactical view, and looking at it, you might notice that a lot of the user interface elements have changed significantly. One of the really hard things about playing a game that's fully 3D is determining the distance of things relative to each other in 3D space. So one of the things I've done here to make it easier is taken a page from EVE Online, which did a really good job at this, which is a range plane that shows on the selected ship, and then there are arced lines that go down to that range. Previously, contacts in your sensor's view would follow a pretty standard sci-fi trope of dropping a line straight down onto a plane, but when you're in 3D space, that doesn't really tell you much about how far away something actually is with hard numbers. So what these arced lines do is that when a contact is 2 kilometers above you, instead of dropping a line straight down on top of your ship, which doesn't give you any information, it'll draw an arc out to the 2 kilometer line on that range plane, and so you can see relative to all of your defensive and weapons and sensor ranges, where that contact falls. Based on the two games that I've played with it since I implemented it, and based on tester feedback, this has gone a really long way to making the tactical view a lot more usable and helping you figure out where things are positioned relative to each other. I'm going to fast forward to my Corvette attack here to talk about the next two major changes. My strategy here, by the way, was to swarm him with Corvettes that each had a jammer crammed onto them so that I could orbit at a relatively close distance, provide sensor data back to my sniping railgun cruiser, and keep him jammed. Unfortunately, they weren't able to get close enough before getting destroyed by the missiles, so it didn't really end up working out for me. But anyway, for a long time, you could just set flank speed on your ships, and there was no reason to ever not do that because they'd get more engine power and they'd have a 120% higher top speed. Now, obviously, having that be unlimited is a bad thing, and it's something I've been meaning to get to, so now having your ship set to travel at flank speed will gradually damage your engines. And this damage is on a per thruster basis, so every second that a thruster is firing, there's a percentage chance that it will do a small amount of damage to itself. This, of course, opens up the opportunity for modifiers on this. So for example, the Corvette, since it's meant to be a fast attack ship, has a base modifier that reduces the probability of thruster damage when the ship is traveling at flank speed. By now, you've probably noticed the flashing exclamation points next to a few of my ships, and that is the next major change, which is catastrophic events. There are two of these events so far, the first of which you're going to see right now, which is a magazine explosion, and that does a lot of damage to any modules inside the ship within a certain radius. The second of these events is, well,
that jamming was a bit annoying, but it was real local. Oh!
Oh, fuck!
Holy, but Jesus!
Woo!
Woohoo! Yeah! Whoever is responsible for that one. Wow.
The second is a reactor overload. That explosion will basically cook the hull of any ship that's within about a kilometer and a half radius, and if it's close enough, will do damage to interior components. It also completely obliterates the ship that it was on, so there is no surviving it. These events can be counteracted if your damage control teams get there fast enough, but if you don't have any teams, or they're too far away, or they're all dead, then you're basically going to have to succumb to it. Right now I'm still playing with the probability of these events occurring, so they're going to be pretty rare. Right now they're a lot higher than I think that they should be, but it made for good TV. Because of the limited time I had this sprint, those are the primary major features that I got to implement. I spent the rest of my time on small quality of life changes that I could sit down and do in 30-minute chunks. Most of those changes were in the fleet editor, so let's flip over to that before coming back to talk about future balancing changes based on these two games. I think the last time I showed the fleet editor on a devlog was all the way back in devlog number 1. So you may have seen screenshots in the Discord or a stream that we were doing of someone building a fleet, but a lot has changed since then, so let's go through those changes. So up at the top here, we have the list of ships in your fleet, which is now a click to scroll that always shows five ships, so you don't see half of icons anymore. There's now a duplicate ship button, so you don't need to add a hull and manually remember and re-add every module that you had on the other ship. Adding hulls is also much nicer. The ship hull list, instead of just being a list of the hulls, now has this detail pane. It shows you a screenshot of the ship in action, some flavor text and background stuff, and it shows you the stats down here and any modifiers. So here's the flank speed damage probability I was talking about for the Corvette. And you can also drag reorder ships in this now. And so this actually affects the order of the ships in the ship list in game. And the reason this is important is because I like to personally keep my capital ships at the front so they're easily accessible through the one hotkey. I like to group ships in here that fly together or that I plan to fly together to make them accessible through the same keys. Over on the left side, where we select what modules are mounted on the ship, we're also using the detailed list now. So when you click on something, it shows you a screenshot of it along with the stats, the relevant stats. Instead of that pane that was on the left-hand side and you'd hover over it to get a tooltip, this is much nicer. You can see everything and scroll through it. You don't have to deal with a tooltip that a lot of the time didn't even fit on the screen for some of the things that had more information associated with them. You can also filter and show only the things that fit on that particular socket and hide the ones that don't. And then the largest quality of life change in the fleet editor is the addition of these design warnings. So it shows me up here. It also puts an icon on the ship and shows me that there's one ship with a warning here so that I know that there's something wrong with my fleet and I don't need to manually check through everything and look for red text somewhere. So I know that I don't have enough crew and I know that I don't have ammo for the cannon. So by replacing this small DC locker with a berthing, that crew warning goes away. I have enough crew now. And if I reduce the amount of ammo here and add some HE shells for the 450mm, that warning goes away because now I know that I have all the ammo that I need for all my weapons and I don't need to worry about going into battle missing something that I need that I didn't know I didn't have. And finally, even though it's not really visible here, a major change is that I implemented stacking penalties. So you can no longer just add a dozen ammunition elevators and get a 500% bonus to your reload speed. The first modifier gets 100% of its bonus, then 80% roughly, then about 33%, then 1%, and everything else after that is basically completely useless. So you can't just infinitely stack your bonuses and specialize your ship into one thing as far as possible. So to finish off this devlog, let's talk about balancing. I said we played two of these games. In both of them, my opponent was using the same fleet, all missile kinetic attack with electronic warfare also. After the first game, where he also won, I made a number of changes to missiles to hopefully improve the balance. Those changes were increasing the storage size of the missiles so that you can carry less of them for the roll-off launchers in magazines. I also increased the cost of missiles, so the same fleet that he used in the first match, which cost 2,000 points, cost 3,000 points in the second game, which allowed me to bring more ships. Those changes brought things in line a little bit more in that by the end of the match, he only had 4 missiles left on all of his ships. But I had no ships left, so he still defeated me. I also buffed the point defenses considerably. I doubled the range of the point defense laser, made it so that the magazine size for the flak cannon is 30 instead of 3, and I increased the accuracy of the chain gun. But despite all of those buffs to the point defenses, I still took a ton of hits, and the reason for that, I realized, is that E-War is way too overpowered right now. So you'll notice when my point defenses are active, they're shooting all over the place and not coming anywhere close to hitting the missiles. And the reason for that is that they're being cued off of a visual track and trying to establish a fire control lock, but they can't because there's so much jamming. He has 5 ships, each with a jammer on them, and that's just completely saturating the radar. The lasers in particular, which are pinpoint accurate, are useless without a fire control lock because it's not like you're going to get a stray bullet that hits the missile. The issue with jamming right now is not necessarily a power problem in terms of the amount of radiation that they can output to overwhelm the sensors, it's a strategy problem. The optimal strategy right now is to always be jamming because there's not a reason to not jam. Your jammers can run indefinitely, and as long as you're saturating an area with jamming signal, then your enemy can't see you. Because of that, I think the first step to bringing E-War down a notch and making it more balanced is implementing a firing time limit and a cooldown. The reason for this can be that running it too long will burn out the amplifiers, for example. Another answer could be a sensor ping or a burn-through sweep that would do a single cycle of the sensor at a much higher power, running the risk of damaging the sensor but also temporarily burning through the jamming, giving you a single static contact that you can hopefully try to illuminate or get a fire control lock on. And finally, the ability for victims of jamming to eventually acclimate to the jamming and counteract it and be able to see through it, meaning that the longer you're jamming your target, they get used to your jamming, they learn to root out your signal, and so that provides an incentive to not always be constantly jamming a target, only in the most important of circumstances. However, that change is going to take a lot of work, and so that's going to be further down the line. In the meantime, I think that limiting the amount of time that EWAR can be used for continuously will go a long way towards helping make it less overpowered. And finally, I want to start reworking the damage model to make it more realistic. Rather than just armor hit points, I want to start taking into account armor thickness and penetration distances and things like that. Which isn't really related to missile balancing, but it is something I've been wanting to get to for a while, so hopefully I'm going to hit that in the next sprint. So that's it for this update. If you like what you see, if you're interested in the game, please join us on Discord. Please wishlist the game on Steam, as that helps us out a lot. And with that, thank you for watching.